In a house on a hill 12 miles from Amman in the Hashemite kingdom of Jordan lives a princess, daughter of an English colonel, wife of King Hussein, a king who so far has survived a dozen attempts to kill him.
But he puts his life in the hands of Allah, in the hands of God. I mean, we all do it every day. Whether we go to sleep, we don't know the next morning for sure that we're going to wake up, any of us.
Once, the king lived only because a bullet glanced off a medal he was wearing. Today, he knows he occupies the most vulnerable position in the Middle East.
After a lot of practice, and seeing a lot of people and living with them and so on, one almost begins to guess at times what is behind the thoughts of anyone or what his objective really is. There are, in fact, very, very few people one can call personal friends in a position like this.
Good morning, my friend. You have a beautiful 5x9 signal into this QTH, 10 miles northwest of Amman. Alpha, Mike, Mike. Alpha, November, the capital city of Jordan. This is Hussein on the mic.
Hussein lives inside a tight security network. He's an active man and he doesn't take kindly to the restrictions. He finds momentary escape through his hobby as a ham radio operator. He shares the enthusiasm with his wife, Muna, and with his two sons, Abdullah and Faisal. Today, he makes contact with a radio amateur 3,000 miles away in London.
5x9, go ahead.
Yes, thank you very much, Hassan. J11 from Golf 3, Yankee, November, Charlie, and a very good morning to you. Fine on all your comments there. Great line sounds as ever, very nice indeed, and it's my pleasure to work you for the very first time. Did work at JY2 on 20 metres some time ago, but although we've called you from time to time, it's been the inevitable pile-up. Okay, on everything there. WX in London at this time is an overcast, dull overcast morning. Although the temperature's quite mild for the time of year, or very mild, I should say, at 46 degrees outside at the moment.
Off duty, the first language of the royal family is English. Hussein's wife, Muna, was born in Ipswich and lived in Kent before she married Hussein 11 years ago. Both their sons are now at prep school in England. The king himself studied at Harrow and remembers his days at the Royal Military Academy, Sandhurst, as the most formative period of his life.
Roger, Roger, thank you very much indeed, my friend.
Very happy to meet you, and hope to meet you again soon. In the meantime, all the very best of 73s and all the very best wishes for 1972.
But to his people, the Bedouin, Hussein is more than just a king. To them, he's a holy man, a direct descendant of the Prophet Muhammad. It's the Bedouin, the desert people, who've kept the Hashemite dynasty intact through the troubles of the past 10 years. The price has been heavy. Today, the Jordan Valley, the most fertile part of Hussein's kingdom, lies uncultivated and virtually empty. Even the Palestinians who sought refuge on the East Bank 20 years ago are gone. The Six-Day War with Israel and the border incidents since have driven them further from their homes and deeper into Hussein's kingdom. Almost half Hussein's 2 million or so subjects are Palestinian. Many of them still live in refugee camps like this one near Amman, housing 20,000 people. Hussein has given them Jordanian citizenship, but he can't get their land back, nor can he find work for many of them. Two years ago, these camps were full of guns and guerrillas. Hussein tolerated this growth of a state within a state until he virtually lost control.
And on a crossroad, where there was a military police checkpost, we found that one side of the road was closed, and the other side also was blocked by an army lorry. No one inside. We stopped, two cars ahead of me and mine. And at that precise moment, heavy machine gun fire opened. Up on us, the car in front of me immediately, the sergeant in it, and soldiers began to fall out. And it was coming our way. I was stunned for a little while and angered. And then I realized what had happened, so I jumped out of the vehicle and rolled into a ditch, and we fired back. The cars were turned around. I got back into the car and realized I'd lost my berry in the ditch, so I decided I'd go back and get it, and which I did.
Why?
I don't know, I just couldn't leave it there. And we left.
But you could have died going back for your berry.
I know, may sound ridiculous, and it did afterwards, but that was the case.
Did you fear death at that moment?
No. And I've never feared death, really, in any of the many incidents that had occurred to me or dangers I'd passed through. There were moments, I must say, when one thought that was really the end, but in terms of fear, I don't think it was there.
Do you mean that you've never known fear?
No, I have known fear, a different kind of fear.
What sort of fear?
A fear of myself. A fear of failing the people who have faith in me. A fear of not being able to live with myself as a result of letting them down in some way or another.
He says that he doesn't fear death. Do you believe him?
Yes, I do. I have the same attitude as he does. I think this has grown in the number of years that we've been together. That if you're in fear of death every day, life is not really worth living, to worry about it. When your time comes, your time comes, so why not live life to the full? And why worry about death?
But you yourself have said that many attempts have been made on his life. How can you come to terms with this? I mean, it's almost as if he may leave the house today and not come back.
Well, it's the same with any man who walks out of a house to go to work. He may not come back again.
It applies rather more so to your husband than to most.
Yes, it does, but it's nothing that I worry about. I know he's well guarded. I know he won't do anything silly for an accident to happen. And what if an accident happens? Well, there's very little anybody can do about it anyway.
You use the word accident rather than assassination attempt.
Yes, I suppose I do. I've never been here when there's been an assassination attempt on His Majesty. And each one he's come out all right with. But accidents on a car, or accidents on a horse, or in a plane, I think are far more liable in the everyday life than an assassination.
Not to your husband, though?
Well, this is the way I feel.
Is it?
I know he can be assassinated at any time, but then anybody can. I feel that, I treat him as an ordinary man. He feels better, he's an ordinary man. And my thinking is along that lines, that it can happen to anybody at any time.
Must you treat him for your own peace of mind as an ordinary man?
I think if I treat him normally, without any worry, it saves him worrying.
But he is the sort of man who will, after having been shot at with a machine gun, will dive into a ditch in order to get his berry back. I mean, that was extraordinary thing to do.
Oh, I didn't know that story.
Maybe I shouldn't have told you.
I didn't know that. Well, I know that he had three gentlemen, rather large, hefty gentlemen, dive on his back and injure his back for him.
Yes. Have you yourself thought of the personal danger involved in being his wife?
I know the danger involved in being his wife. But again, the one thing I have tried to make, ever since I've been married to His Majesty, that he gets a normal family life as much as possible. He has enough of politics and all these decisions all day long. He has people seeing him all day long with all their problems. and I try and keep as many problems away from him as possible. So the subject very seldom comes up. And we know, we all know it's there. Even, I think even the children have a sense that it's there. But it's never talked about. We try to keep here, when His Majesty comes home, as a family atmosphere. And I think we do it quite well.
We can hear the family atmosphere now.
Yes.
The Husseins' twin daughters are now 3 years old. Their sons, aged 10 and 8, will soon return to their English prep school.
Put his leg out, I tripped, and the boy came round again, and by mistake, told him my face.
You've nearly lost the tooth, haven't you?
Nearly lost the black eye.
And the black eye? He always comes back with a black eye.
He always comes home with a black eye.
Don't say that, Danny!
Shush up.
But the decision to educate the young princes in England has led to violent attacks on Hussein from Arab nationalists both inside and outside Jordan.
I believe that an Arab, if he's in any part of the world, remains an Arab in terms of his attachment to his country, to his part of the world. And as far as the children are concerned, they have the opportunity of learning their language there as well as here when they are on leave, and keeping in touch with their country in every way and respect. But they are going to public school and hopefully to university eventually in England. And it is only fair that if that is the way things will develop for them, that they should start also by going to prep school.
You are determined about this?
Yes, this is what I hope they will do, and I hope they will follow in my footsteps in terms of going to Harrow at some point in the near future and continuing their studies there.
So the boys joined the army in the summer holidays, and at their request they joined. We have a boys' school here for orphans of soldiers, and the boys are taught, are given a career in the army. The boys went one day with their father. They saw the young boys doing what they've always wanted to do, and so they asked if they could join. So there it was, 6:30 every morning, going off to the regiment, and then coming back about 3:00 in the afternoon, and thoroughly enjoying it. Sending them like this to the artillery with the boys, of course, it increased their Arabic, because everything is done in Arabic. Mm. And they proved an awful lot just in the short while they were there with them.
So the young princes, Abdullah and Faisal, go back to the school where last year they underwent their basic military training. The system in the Jordanian army provides for a youngster, even at the age of 12, to join a select regiment and stay with a particular tank or piece of artillery throughout his army service. It's the army who have kept Hussein on his throne. To be protective, then, to his sons and heirs comes naturally to them.
The boys had a passing out parade, and they had a small demonstration on arms and 25-pounders and marching, and they had some obstacle courses to do, and it was very good.
You must have been very proud.
Yes, I was very proud, and I couldn't look at anybody because I had tears streaming down my eyes, because they're so much smaller and so much younger, because most of the boys there are 12 to 14. Faisal, you see, was only 7 at the time, and it's rather a little wee one trying to march with all the bigger boys. But again, he managed it, and I was very proud of the two of them because they saluted nicely, they marched nicely.
So the boys acquitted themselves well in training. But does their mother one day want her eldest son to be king?
No, not really. I know what my husband goes through, I know the pressures, and I would hate to think of anybody taking that job, really. It's not an easy job, and I really wouldn't wish it on either of my children. But if the boy is like His Majesty so much, he possibly might take over. This is a decision that His Majesty has to make.
If Allah wills it.
If Allah wills it.
In political terms, Hussein is a man alone. Treated with reserve or downright hostility by his Arab neighbours, coping with 1 million Palestinian refugees within his borders, facing the might of Israel across the River Jordan. Today, he goes to the Jordan Valley to show the flag, to show that he can visit the river under the noses of the Israelis. Those Arabs who've stayed welcome him. The message for those who've left is clear. Hussein wants them to return to the valley, to cultivate their farms, to rebuild their homes. He goes as far as the Allenby Bridge, watched and recognized by a group of curious Israeli soldiers. 30 miles up that road is Jerusalem, once part of Hussein's kingdom.
What are your feelings now as you look over that bridge and you see the Israeli troops are looking at you?
Well, our hope is that this is a temporary situation that will not last terribly long. We know what we are striving for, and we are committed to it.
What do you mean by that, sir?
I mean to stand, to safeguard our national unity, to stand in the face of all threats and every challenge, and to work for the recovery of our lost territory and the establishment of a just and durable peace.
Near the bridge, he meets a crowd of Arabs from the Gaza Strip. The Israelis who now occupy the Strip have permitted them to make a pilgrimage to Mecca. Hussein's bodyguard is jumpy. How much of the anti-Hussein propaganda have these Palestinians believed? But even allowing for Arab hyperbole, the confrontation is a triumph for Hussein. You are the king above all kings, they cry. It is you who must lead us and lead us to victory. Yet Arab unity is an ever-receding dream. For Hussein, it's proved difficult enough even to achieve unity inside his own borders. Today, an uneasy peace lies over Jordan, in spite of the defeat of the guerrillas in September 1970.
Right to the very last possible second, we tried to prevent the clash from occurring. But Jordan had unfortunately turned into the battlefield of all the different ideologies that exist in this world, and no matter how we tried, it was always misinterpreted for weakness. But then came a time when I nearly lost control of the army. In one place, they told me to just stand out of their way if I could not save their dignity and their honor. And I tried to delay a decision, but once there was no option, and the fight was on. We went into it with every conviction that was the only course left to us, no matter what. And I didn't have any doubts whatsoever.
And yet, in order to stay in power, thousands of Palestinians, guerrillas, and refugees had to die.
Not so much in order to stay in power, but in order to prevent a state of chaos and the biggest massacre that could have ever occurred and or was likely to be thought possible might have occurred when everyone in a state of complete agitation and anger could have killed each other in this country and destroyed it.
But was there no other way?
There was none that I could have found, and I tried my utmost to the limit including asking Arab leaders to help. It was always the same answer. It's your problem. Deal with it.
You seem most concerned today about Arab disunity.
Yes. People appear more interested in playing with the emotions of the masses here and there from day to day and trying to secure their positions and maintain their positions or achieve power and hang on to it, or they don't realize what is happening, or they're unwilling to contribute what they should towards building Arab strength and thus a better future.
You haven't a very high opinion of politicians, some politicians. Politicians,
no.
Perhaps in general.
Well, I wouldn't generalize, but the majority, certainly in this part of the world, I have very little respect for, really.
Yet you yourself have proved to be an extremely astute politician. For a king?
Oh, I don't know if that really applies. I have seen it's almost a jungle, really, in every respect, in terms of many. And there's so much waste. We have known that the objective of some of Palestinian origin, some Arabs, some outsiders, and possibly even the people across the ceasefire line, is to destroy the national unity of this country. They tried that. When they forced the fight, they did not succeed. They're trying it again through assassination attempts here and there. Whether they succeed or not, they feel they might cause a situation where an eruption would occur for them to exploit, where Jordan and Palestinian would be at each other's throats again. We're trying to deny them this chance.
If Hussein denies them that chance, it will be because of three things: his own personal commitment and political skill, the inefficiency of his enemies, and perhaps most important of all, the loyalty of his army, who, as always, welcome him enthusiastically. Hussein is a man with an uncanny ability to survive. His enemies have tried to poison him, shoot him, and blow him up, always unsuccessfully. But today, the security around Hussein is tighter than ever before. The Palestinian extremists are bent on revenge against the man they believe has sold them out. Just as last November, they swore revenge on his prime minister, Wasfi Tell.
Wasfi Tell is dead. Are you currently under the threat of assassination from Palestinians?
Oh, Wasfi was on a list. The list is a very long one. And,
but you're at the top of the list.
On top of that list, at the top of it. But when it comes, it comes, if it does come.
Has given them Jordanian citizenship, but he can't get their land back, nor can he find work for many of them. Two years ago, these camps were full of guns and guerrillas. Hussein tolerated this growth of a state within a state until he virtually lost control.
And on a crossroad, where there was a military police checkpost, we found that one side of the road was closed and the other side also was blocked by an army lorry. No one inside. We stopped, two cars ahead of me and mine, And at that precise moment, heavy machine gun fire opened. Up on us, the car in front of me immediately, the sergeant in it, and soldiers began to fall out. And it was coming our way. I was stunned for a little while and angered. And then I realized what had happened, so I jumped out of the vehicle and rolled into a ditch, and we fired back. The cars were turned around. I got back into the car and realized I'd lost my berry in the ditch, so I decided I'd go back and get it, and which I did.
Why?
I don't know, I just couldn't leave it there. And we left.
But you could have died going back for your berry.
I know, it may sound ridiculous, and it did afterwards, but that was the case.
Did you fear death at that moment?
No. And I've never feared death, really, in any of the many incidents that had occurred to me or dangers that passed through. There were moments, I must say, when one thought that was really the end, but in terms of fear, I don't think it was there.
Do you mean that you've never known fear?
No, I have known fear, a different kind of fear.
What sort of fear?
Fear of myself. A fear of failing the people who have faith in me. Fear of not being able to live with myself as a result of letting them down in some way or another.
He says that he doesn't fear death. Do you believe him?
Yes, I do. I have the same attitude as he does. I think this has grown in the number of years that we've been together. That if you're in fear of death every day, life is not really worth living, to worry about it. When your time comes, your time comes, so why not live life to the full? And why worry about death?
But you yourself have said that many attempts have been made on his life. How can you come to terms with this? I mean, it's almost as if he may leave the house today and not come back.
Well, it's the same with any man who walks out of a house to go to work. He may not come back again.
It applies rather more so to your husband than to most.
Yes, it does, but it's nothing that I worry about. I know he's well guarded. I know he won't do anything silly for an accident to happen. And what if an accident happens? Well, there's very little anybody can do about it anyway.
You use the word accident rather than assassination attempt.
Yes, I suppose I do. I've never been here when there's been an assassination attempt on His Majesty. And each one he's come out all right with. But accidents on a car, or accidents on a horse, or in a plane, I think are far more liable in the everyday life than an assassination.
Not to your husband, though?
Well, this is the way I feel.
Is it,
I know he can be assassinated at any time, but then anybody can. I feel that, I treat him as an ordinary man. He feels better, he's an ordinary man. And my thinking is along that lines, that it can happen to anybody at any time.
Must you treat him for your own peace of mind as an ordinary man?
I think if I treat him normally, without any worry, it saves him worrying.
But he is the sort of man who will, after having been shot at with a machine gun, will dive into a ditch in order to get his berry back. I mean, that was extraordinary thing to do.
Oh, I didn't know that story.
Maybe I shouldn't have told you.
I didn't know that. Well, I know that he had three gentlemen, rather large, hefty gentlemen, dive on his back and injure his back for him.
Yes. Have you yourself thought of the personal danger involved in being his wife?
I know the danger involved in being his wife. But again, the one thing I have tried to make, ever since I've been married to His Majesty, that he gets a normal family life as much as possible. He has enough of politics and all these decisions all day long. He has people seeing him all day long with all their problems. and I try and keep as many problems away from him as possible. So the subject very seldom comes up. And we know, we all know it's there. Even, I think even the children have a sense that it's there. But it's never talked about. We try to keep here, when His Majesty comes home, as a family atmosphere. And I think we do it quite well.
We can hear the family atmosphere now.
Yes.
The Husseins' twin daughters are now 3 years old. Their sons, aged 10 and 8, will soon return to their English prep school.
Put his leg out, I tripped, and the ball came round again, and by mistake, told him my kids.
You've nearly lost a tooth, haven't you? And the black eye. He always comes back with a black eye.
He always comes home with a black eye.
But the decision to educate the young princes in England has led to violent attacks on Hussein from Arab nationalists both inside and outside Jordan.
I believe that an Arab, if he's in any part of the world, remains an Arab in terms of his attachment to his country, to his part of the world. And as far as the children are concerned, they have the opportunity of learning their language there, as well as here when they are on leave, and keeping in touch with their country in every way and respect. But they are going to public school and hopefully to university eventually in England. And it is only fair that if that is the way things will develop for them, and they should start also by going to prep school.
You are determined about this?
Yes, this is what I hope they will do, and I hope they will follow in my footsteps in terms of going to Harrow at some point in the near future and continuing their studies there.
So the boys joined the army in the summer holidays, and at their request they joined. We have a boys' school here for orphans of soldiers, and the boys are taught, are given a career in the army. The boys went one day with their father. They saw the young boys doing what they've always wanted to do, and so they asked if they could join. So there it was, 6:30 every morning, going off to the regiment, and then coming back about 3 o'clock in the afternoon, and thoroughly enjoying it. Sending them like this to the artillery with the boys, of course, it increased their Arabic, because everything is done in Arabic.
And the establishment of a just and durable peace.
Near the bridge, he meets a crowd of Arabs from the Gaza Strip. The Israelis who now occupy the Strip have permitted them to make a pilgrimage to Mecca. Hussein's bodyguard is jumpy. How much of the anti-Hussein propaganda have these Palestinians believed? But even allowing for Arab hyperbole, the confrontation is a triumph for Hussein. You are the king above all kings, they cry. It is you who must lead us and lead us to victory. Yet Arab unity is an ever-receding dream. For Hussein, it's proved difficult enough even to achieve unity inside his own borders. Today, an uneasy peace lies over Jordan, in spite of the defeat of the guerrillas in September 1970.
Right to the very last possible second, we tried to prevent the clash from occurring. But Jordan had unfortunately turned into the battlefield of all the different ideologies that exist in this world, and no matter how we tried, it was always misinterpreted for weakness. But then came a time when I nearly lost control of the army. In one place, they told me to just stand out of their way if I could not save their dignity and their honor. And I tried to delay a decision, but once there was no option, and the fight was on. We went into it with every conviction that that was the only course left to us, no matter what. And I didn't have any doubts whatsoever.
And yet, in order to stay in power, thousands of Palestinians, guerrillas, and refugees had to die.
Not so much in order to stay in power, but in order to prevent a state of chaos and the biggest massacre that could have ever occurred and or was likely to be thought possible might have occurred. When everyone in a state of complete agitation and anger could have killed each other in this country and destroyed it.
But was there no other way?
There was none that I could have found, and I tried my utmost to the limit, including asking Arab leaders to help. It was always the same answer. It's your problem. Deal with it.
You seem most concerned today about Arab disunity.
Yes. People appear more interested in playing with the emotions of the masses here and there from day to day and trying to secure their positions and maintain their positions or achieve power and hang on to it, or they don't realize what is happening, or they're unwilling to contribute what they should towards building Arab strength and thus a better future.
You haven't a very high opinion of politicians, some politicians. Politicians,
no.
Perhaps in general.
Well, I wouldn't generalize, but the majority, certainly in this part of the world, I have very little respect for, really.
Yet you yourself have proved to be an extremely astute politician. For a king.
Oh, I don't know if that really applies. I have seen it's almost a jungle, really, in every respect, in terms of money. And there's so much waste. We have known that the objective of some of Palestinian origin, some Arabs, some outsiders, and possibly even the people across the ceasefire line, is to destroy the national unity of this country. They tried that. When they forced the fight, they did not succeed. They're trying it again through assassination attempts here and there. Whether they succeed or not, they feel they might cause.
In a house on a hill 12 miles from Amman in the Hashemite kingdom of Jordan lives a princess, daughter of an English colonel, wife of King Hussein, a king who so far has survived a dozen attempts to kill him.
But he puts his life in the hands of Allah, in the hands of God. I mean, we all do it every day. Whether we go to sleep, we don't know the next morning for sure that we're going to wake up, any of us.
Once, the king lived only because a bullet glanced off a medal he was wearing. Today, he knows he occupies the most vulnerable position in the Middle East.
After a lot of practice and seeing a lot of people and living with them and so on, one almost begins to guess at times what is behind the thoughts of anyone or what his objective really is. There are, in fact, very, very few people one can call personal friends in a position like this.
Good morning, my friend. You have a beautiful 5x9 signal into this QTH, 10 miles northwest of Amman. Alpha, Mike, Mike. Alpha, November, the capital city of Jordan. This is Hussein on the mic.
Hussein lives inside a tight security network. He's an active man, and he doesn't take kindly to the restrictions. He finds momentary escape through his hobby as a ham radio operator. He shares the enthusiasm with his wife, Muna, and with his two sons, Abdullah and Faisal. Today, he makes contact with a radio amateur 3,000 miles away in London.
5x9, go ahead.
Yes, thank you very much, Hassan. JY1 from Golf 3, Yankee, November, Charlie, and a very good morning to you. Fine on all your comments there. Great line sounds as ever, very nice indeed, and it's my pleasure to work you for the very first time. Did work JY2 on 20 metres some time ago, but although we've called you from time to time, there's been the inevitable pile-up. Okay, on everything there. WX in London at this time is an overcast, dull overcast morning. Although the temperature's quite mild for the time of year, or very mild, I should say, at 46 degrees outside at the moment.
Look up here, DJ, DK or DL. That's German.
That's German.
That's German. So I heard all the countries here.
Off duty, the first language of the royal family is English. Hussein's wife, Muna, was born in Ipswich and lived in Kent before she married Hussein 11 years ago. Both their sons are now at prep school in England. The king himself studied at Harrow and remembers his days at the Royal Military Academy, Sandhurst, as the most formative period of his life.
Roger, Roger, thank you very much indeed, my friend.
Very happy to meet you, and hope to meet you again soon. In the meantime, all the very best of 73s and all the very best wishes for 1972.
But to his people, the Bedouin, Hussein is more than just a king. To them, he's a holy man, a direct descendant of the Prophet Muhammad. It's the Bedouin, the desert people, who've kept the Hashemite dynasty intact through the troubles of the past 10 years. The price has been heavy. Today, the Jordan Valley, the most fertile part of Hussein's kingdom, lies uncultivated and virtually empty. Even the Palestinians who sought refuge on the East Bank 20 years ago are gone. The Six-Day War with Israel and the border incidents since have driven them further from their homes and deeper into Hussein's kingdom. Almost half Hussein's 2 million or so subjects are Palestinian. Many of them still live in refugee camps like this one near Amman, housing 20,000 people. Hussein.
And they proved an awful lot just in the short while they were there with them.
So the young princes, Abdullah and Faisal, go back to the school where last year they underwent their basic military training. The system in the Jordanian army provides for a youngster, even at the age of 12, to join a select regiment and stay with a particular tank or piece of artillery throughout his army service. It's the army who have kept Hussein on his throne. To be protective, then, to his sons and heirs comes naturally to them.
The boys had a passing out parade, and they had a small demonstration on arms and 25-pounders and marching. And they had some obstacle courses to do, and it was very good.
You must have been very proud.
Yes, I was very proud, and I couldn't look at anybody because I had tears streaming down my eyes, because they're so much smaller and so much younger, because most of the boys there are 12 to 14. Faisal, you see, was only 7 at the time, and it's rather a little wee one trying to march with all the bigger boys. But again, he managed it, and I was very proud of the two of them, because they saluted nicely, they marched nicely.
So the boys acquitted themselves well in training. But does their mother, one day, want her eldest son to be king?
No, not really. I know what my husband goes through, I know the pressures, and I would hate to think of anybody taking that job, really. It's not an easy job, and I really wouldn't wish it on either of my children. But if the boy is like His Majesty so much, he possibly might take over. This is a decision that His Majesty has to make.
If Allah wills it.
If Allah wills it.
In political terms, Hussein is a man alone. Treated with reserve or downright hostility by his Arab neighbours, coping with 1 million Palestinian refugees within his borders, facing the might of Israel across the River Jordan. Today, he goes to the Jordan Valley to show the flag, to show that he can visit the river under the noses of the Israelis. Those Arabs who've stayed welcome him. The message for those who've left is clear. Hussein wants them to return to the valley, to cultivate their farms, to rebuild their homes. He goes as far as the Allenby Bridge, watched and recognized by a group of curious Israeli soldiers. 30 miles up that road is Jerusalem, once part of Hussein's kingdom.
What are your feelings now as you look over that bridge and you see the Israeli troops are looking at you?
Well, our hope is that this is a temporary situation that will not last terribly long. We know what we are striving for, and we are committed to it.
What do you mean by that, sir?
I mean to stand, to safeguard our national unity, to stand in the face of all threats and every challenge, and to work for the recovery.
A small demonstration on arms and 25 pounders and marching. And they had some obstacle courses to do, and it was very good.
You must have been very proud.
Yes, I was very proud, and I couldn't look at anybody because I had tears streaming down my eyes, because they're so much smaller and so much younger, because most of the boys there are 12 to 14. Faisal, you see, was only 7 at the time, and it's rather a little wee one trying to march with all the bigger boys. But again, he managed it, and I was very proud of the two of them, because they saluted nicely, they marched nicely.
So the boys acquitted themselves well in training. But does their mother one day want her eldest son to be king?
No, not really. I know what my husband goes through, I know the pressures, and I would hate to think of anybody taking that job, really. It's not an easy job, and I really wouldn't wish it on either of my children. But if the boy is like His Majesty so much, he possibly might take over. But this is a decision that His Majesty has to make.
If Allah wills it.
If Allah wills it.
In political terms, Hussein is a man alone. Treated with reserve or downright hostility by his Arab neighbours, coping with 1 million Palestinian refugees within his borders, facing the might of Israel across the River Jordan. Today, he goes to the Jordan Valley to show the flag, to show that he can visit the river under the noses of the Israelis. Those Arabs who've stayed welcome him. The message for those who've left is clear. Hussein wants them to return to the valley, to cultivate their farms, to rebuild their homes. He goes as far as the Allenby Bridge, watched and recognized by a group of curious Israeli soldiers. 30 miles up that road is Jerusalem, once part of Hussein's kingdom.
What are your feelings now as you look over that bridge and you see the Israeli troops are looking at you?
Well, our hope is that this is a temporary situation that will not last terribly long. We know what we are striving for, and we are committed to it.
What do you mean by that, sir?
I mean to stand, to safeguard our national unity, to stand in the face of all threats and every challenge, and to work for the recovery of our lost territory and the establishment of a just and durable peace.
Near the bridge, he meets a crowd of Arabs from the Gaza Strip. The Israelis who now occupy the Strip have permitted them to make a pilgrimage to Mecca. Hussein's bodyguard is jumpy.
It's from O'Kerry. But Jordan had unfortunately turned into the battlefield of all the different ideologies that exist in this world, and no matter how we tried, it was always misinterpreted for weakness. But then came a time when I nearly lost control of the army. In one place, they told me to just stand out of their way if I could not save their dignity and their honor. And I tried to delay a decision. But once there was no option, the fight was on. We went into it with every conviction that that was the only course left to us, no matter what. And I didn't have any doubts whatsoever.
And yet, in order to stay in power, thousands of Palestinians, guerrillas, and refugees had to die.
Not so much in order to stay in power, but in order to prevent a state of chaos and the biggest massacre that could have ever occurred and or was likely to be thought possible might have occurred when everyone in a state of complete agitation and anger could have killed each other in this country and destroyed it.
But was there no other way?
There was none that I could have found, and I tried my utmost to the limit, including asking Arab leaders to help. It was always the same answer. It's your problem. Deal with it.
You seem most concerned today about Arab disunity.
Yes. People appear more interested in playing with the emotions of the masses here and there from day to day and trying to secure their positions and maintain their positions or achieve power and hang on to it, or they don't realize what is happening, or they're unwilling to contribute what they should towards building Arab strength and thus a better future.
You haven't a very high opinion of politicians, some politicians. Politicians,
no.
Perhaps in general.
Well, I wouldn't generalize, but the majority, certainly in this part of the world, I have very little respect for. Really.
Yet you yourself have proved to be an extremely astute politician for a king.
Oh, I don't know if that really applies. I have seen it's almost a jungle, really, in every respect, in terms of many. And there's so much waste. We have known that the objective of some of Palestinian origin, some Arabs, some outsiders, and possibly even the people across this.
I don't know, I just couldn't leave it there. And we left.
But you could have died going back for your burial.
I know, yeah. Sound ridiculous, and it did afterwards, but that was the case.
Did you fear death at that moment?
No. And I've never feared death, really, in any of the many incidents that had occurred to me or dangers that passed through. There were moments, I must say, when one thought that was really the end, but in terms of fear, I don't think it was there.
Do you mean that you've never known fear?
No, I have known fear, a different kind of fear.
What sort of fear?
A fear of myself, a fear of failing the people who have faith in me. Fear of not being able to live with myself as a result of letting them down in some way or another.
He says that he doesn't fear death. Do you believe him?
Yes, I do. I have the same attitude as he does. I think this has grown in the number of years that we've been together. That if you're in fear of death every day, life is not really worth living to worry about it. When your time comes, your time comes, so why not live life to the full? And why worry about death?
But you yourself have said that many attempts have been made on his life. How can you come to terms with this? I mean, it's almost as if he may leave the house today and not come back.
Well, it's the same with any man who walks out of a house to go to work. He may not come back again.
It applies rather more so to your husband than to most.
Yes, it does, but it's nothing that I worry about. I know he's well guarded. I know he won't do anything silly for an accident to happen. And if an accident happens? Well, there's very little anybody can do about it anyway.
You use the word accident rather than assassination attempt.
Yes, I suppose I do. I've never been here when there's been an assassination attempt on His Majesty. And each one he's come out all right with. But accidents on a car, or accidents on a horse, or in a plane, I think are far more liable in the everyday life than an assassination.
Not to your husband, though?
Well, this is the way I feel.
Is it?
I know he can be assassinated at any time, but then anybody. I feel that I. You see, I treat him as an ordinary man.
Still live in refugee camps like this one near Amman, housing 20,000 people. Hussein has given them Jordanian citizenship, but he can't get their land back, nor can he find work for many of them. Two years ago, these camps were full of guns and guerrillas. Hussein tolerated this growth of a state within a state until he virtually lost control.
And on a crossroad, where there was a military police checkpost, we found that one side of the road was closed, and the other side also was blocked by an army lorry. No one inside. We stopped, two cars ahead of me and mine. And at that precise moment, heavy machine gun fire opened. Up on us. The car in front of me immediately, the sergeant in it, and soldiers began to fall out. And it was coming our way. I was stunned for a little while and angered. And then I realized what had happened, so I jumped out of the vehicle and rolled into a ditch, and we fired back. The cars were turned around. I got back into the car and realized I'd lost my berry in the ditch, so I decided I'd go back and get it, and which I did.
Why?
I don't know, I just couldn't leave it there. And we left.
But you could have died going back for your berry.
I know, may sound ridiculous, and it did afterwards, but that was the case.
Did you fear death at that moment?
No. And I've never feared death, really, in any of the many incidents that had occurred to me or dangers I passed through. There were moments, I must say, when one thought that was really the end, but in terms of fear, I don't think it was there.
Do you mean that you've never known fear?
No, I have known fear, a different kind of fear.
What sort of fear?
Fear of myself. A fear of failing the people who have faith in me. Fear of not being able to live with myself as a result of letting them down in some way or another.
He says that he doesn't fear death. Do you believe him?
Yes, I do. I have the same attitude as he does. I think this has grown in the number of years that we've been together. That...
So the young princes, Abdullah and Faisal, go back to the school where last year they underwent their basic military training. The system in the Jordanian army provides for a youngster, even at the age of 12, to join a select regiment and stay with a particular tank or piece of artillery throughout his army service. It's the army who have kept Hussein on his throne. To be protective, then, to his sons and heirs comes naturally to them.
The boys had a passing out parade, and they had a small demonstration on arms and 25-pounders and marching. And they had some obstacle courses to do, and it was very good.
You must have been very proud.
Yes, I was very proud, and I couldn't look at anybody because I had tears streaming down my eyes. Because They're so much smaller and so much younger, because most of the boys there are 12 to 14. Faisal, you see, was only 7 at the time, and it's rather a little wee one trying to march with all the bigger boys. But again, he managed it, and I was very proud of the two of them, because they saluted nicely, they marched nicely.
So the boys acquitted themselves well in training. But does their mother, one day, want her eldest son to be king?
No, not really. I know what my husband goes through, I know the pressures, and I would hate to think of anybody taking that job, really. It's not an easy job, and I really wouldn't wish it on either of my children. But if the boy is like His Majesty so much, he possibly might take over. This is a decision that His Majesty has to make.
If Allah wills it.
If Allah wills it.
In political terms, Hussein is a man alone, treated that he can visit the river under the noses of the Israelis. Those Arabs who stayed welcome him. The message for those who've left is clear. Hussein wants them to return to the valley, to cultivate their farms, to rebuild their homes. He goes as far as the Allenby Bridge, watched and recognized by a group of curious Israeli soldiers. 30 miles up that road is Jerusalem, once part of Hussein's kingdom.
What are your feelings now as you look over that bridge and you see the Israeli troops are looking at you?
Well, our hope is that this is a temporary situation that will not last terribly long. We know what we are striving for, and we are committed to it.
What do you mean by that, sir?
I mean to stand, to safeguard our national unity, to stand in the face of all threats and every challenge, and to work for the recovery of our lost territory and the establishment of a just and durable peace.
Near the bridge, he meets a crowd of Arabs from the Gaza Strip. The Israelis who now occupy the Strip have permitted them to make a pilgrimage to Mecca. Hussein's bodyguard is jumpy. How much of the anti-Hussein propaganda have these Palestinians believed? But even allowing for Arab hyperbole, the confrontation is a triumph for Hussein. You are the king above all kings, they cry. It is you who must lead us and lead us to victory. Yet Arab unity is an ever-receding dream. For Hussein, it's proved difficult enough even to achieve unity inside his own borders. Today, an uneasy peace lies over Jordan, in spite of the defeat of the guerrillas in September 1970.
Right to the very last possible second, we tried to prevent the clash from occurring. But Jordan had unfortunately turned into the battlefield of all the different ideologies that exist in this world, and no matter how we tried, it was always misinterpreted for weakness. But then came a time when I nearly lost control of the army. In one place, they told me to just stand out of their way if I could not save their dignity and their honor. And I tried to delay a decision, but once there was no option, and the fight was on. We went into it with every conviction that that was the only course left to us, no matter what. And I didn't have any doubts whatsoever.
And yet, in order to stay in power, thousands of Palestinians, guerrillas, left the house today and not come back.
Well, it's the same with any man who walks out of a house to go to work. He may not come back again.
It applies rather more so to your husband than to most.
Yes, it does, but it's nothing that I worry about. I know he's well guarded. I know he won't do anything silly for an accident to happen. And what if an accident happens? Well, there's very little anybody can do about it anyway.
You use the word accident rather than assassination attempt.
Yes, I suppose I do. I've never been here when there's been an assassination attempt on His Majesty. And each one he's come out all right with. But accidents on a car, or accidents on a horse, or in a plane, I think are far more liable in everyday life than an assassination.
Not to your husband, though?
Well, this is the way I feel.
Is it,
I know he can be assassinated at any time, but then anybody can. I feel that, I treat him as an ordinary man. He feels better, he's an ordinary man. And my thinking is along that lines, that it can happen to anybody at any time.
Must you treat him for your own peace of mind as an ordinary man?
I think if I treat him normally, without any worry, it saves him worrying.
But he is the sort of man who will, after having been shot at with a machine gun, will dive into a ditch in order to get his berry back. I mean, that was an extraordinary thing to do.
Oh, I didn't know that story.
Maybe I shouldn't have told you.
I didn't know that. Well, I know that he had three gentlemen, rather large, hefty gentlemen, dive on his back and injure his back for him.
Yes. Have you yourself thought of the personal danger involved in being his wife?
I know the danger involved in being his wife. But again, the one thing I have tried to make, ever since I've been married to His Majesty, that he gets a normal family life as much as possible. He has enough of politics and all these decisions all day long. He has people seeing him all day long with all their problems. And I try and keep as many problems away from him as possible. So the subject very seldom comes up. And we know, we all know it's there. I think even the children have a sense that it's there. But it's never talked about. We try to keep here, when His Majesty comes home, as a family atmosphere. And I think we do it quite well.
We can hear the family atmosphere now.
Yes.
The Husseins' twin daughters are now 3 years. Their sons, aged 10 and 8, will soon return to their English prep school.
Put his leg out, I tripped, and the boy came round again, and by mistake, tore him my face.
You've nearly lost a tooth, haven't you? And the black eye. He always comes back with a black eye.
He always comes home with a black eye.
Don't say that, Sammy.
Sasha, it's time. But the decision to educate the young princes in England has led to violent attacks on Hussein from Arab nationalists both inside and outside Jordan.
I believe that an Arab, if he's in any part of the world, remains an Arab in terms of his attachment to his country, to his part of the world. And as far as the children are concerned, they have the opportunity of learning their language there, as well as here when they are on leave, and keeping in touch with their country in every way and respect. But they are going to public school and hopefully to university eventually in England. And it is only fair that if that is the way things will develop for them, they should start also by going to prep school.
You are determined about this?
Yes, this is what I hope they will do, and I hope they will follow in my footsteps in terms of going to Harrow at some point in the near future and continuing their studies there.
So the boys joined the army in the summer holidays, and at their request they joined. We have a boys' school here for orphans of soldiers, and the boys are taught, are given a career in the army. The boys went one day with their father. They saw the young boys doing what they've always wanted to do, and so they asked if they could join. So there it was, 6:30 every morning, going off to the regiment, and then coming back about 3:00 in the afternoon, and thoroughly enjoying it. Sending them like this to the artillery with the boys, of course, it increased their Arabic, because everything is done in Arabic.
And the establishment of a just and durable peace.
Near the bridge, he meets a crowd of Arabs from the Gaza Strip. The Israelis who now occupy the Strip have permitted them to make a pilgrimage to Mecca. Hussein's bodyguard is jumpy. how much of the anti-Hussein propaganda have these Palestinians believed? But even allowing for Arab hyperbole, the confrontation is a triumph for Hussein. You are the king above all kings, they cry.
Fool. Why worry about death?
But you yourself have said that many attempts have been made on his life. How can you come to terms with this? I mean, it's almost as if he may leave the house today and not come back.
Well, it's the same with any man who walks out of a house to go to work. He may not come back again.
It's rather, it applies rather more so to your husband than to most.
Yes, it does, but it's nothing that I worry about. I know he's well guarded. I know he won't do anything silly to for an accident to happen. And what if an accident happens? Well, there's very little anybody can do about it anyway.
You use the word accident rather than assassination attempt.
Yes, I suppose I do. I've never been here when there's been an assassination attempt on His Majesty. And each one he's come out all right with. But accidents on a car, or accidents on a horse, or in a plane, I think are far more liable in everyday life than an assassination.
Not to your husband, though?
Well, this is the way I feel.
Is it?
I know he can be assassinated at any time, but then anybody can. I feel that, I treat him as an ordinary man. He feels better, he's an ordinary man. And my thinking is along that lines, that it can happen to anybody at any time.
Must you treat him for your own peace of mind as an ordinary man?
I think if I treat him normally, without any worry, it saves him worrying.
But he is the sort of man who will, after having been shot at with a machine gun, will dive into a ditch in order to get his berry back. I mean, that was an extraordinary thing to do.
Oh, I didn't know that story.
Maybe I shouldn't have told you.
I didn't know that. Well, I know that he had three gentlemen, rather large, hefty gentlemen, dive on his back and injure his back for him.
Yes. Have you yourself thought of the personal danger involved in being his wife?
I know the danger involved in being his wife. But again, the one thing I have tried to make, ever since I've been married to His Majesty, that he gets a normal family life as much as possible. He has enough of politics and all these decisions all day long. He has people seeing him all day long with all their problems. And I try and keep as many problems away from him as possible. So the subject very seldom comes up. And we all know it's there. I think the children have a sense that it's there. But it's never talked about.
Jordan lives a princess, daughter of an English colonel, wife of King Hussein, a king who so far has survived a dozen attempts to kill him.
But he puts his life in the hands of Allah, in the hands of God. I mean, we all do every day. Whether we go to sleep, we don't know the next morning for sure that we're going to wake up, any of us.
Once, the king lived only because a bullet glanced off a medal he was wearing. Today, he knows he occupies the most vulnerable position in the Middle East.
After a lot of practice and seeing a lot of people and living with them and so on, one almost begins to guess at times what is behind the thoughts of anyone or what his objective really is. There are, in fact, very, very few people one can call personal friends in a position like this.
Good morning, my friend. You have a beautiful 5x9 signal into this QTH, 10 miles northwest of Amman. Alpha, Mike, Alpha November, the capital city of Jordan. This is Hussein on the mic.
Hussein lives inside a tight security network. He's an active man and he doesn't take kindly to the restrictions. He finds momentary escape through his hobby as a ham radio operator. He shares the enthusiasm with his wife, Muna, and with his two sons, Abdullah and Faisal. Today, he makes contact with a radio amateur 3,000 miles away in London.
5x9, go ahead.
Yes, thank you very much, Hassan. J11 from Golf 3, Yankee November, Charlie, and a very good morning to you. Fine on
all your comments there. Drake Line sounds as ever, very nice indeed, and it's my pleasure to work you for the very first time. Did work JY2 on 20 metres some time ago, but although we've called you from time to time, there's been the inevitable pile-up. Okay, on everything there. WX in London at this time is an overcast, dull overcast morning. Although the temperature's quite mild for the time of year, or very mild, I should say, at 46 degrees outside at the moment.
Equipment here, DJ, DK, or DL. That's German.
That's German.
That's German. So I heard all the countries there.
Off duty, the first language of the royal family is English. Hussein's wife, Muna, was born in Ipswich and lived in Kent before she married Hussein 11 years ago. Both their sons are now at prep school in England. The king himself studied at Harrow and remembers his days at the Royal Military Academy, Sandhurst, as the most formative period of his life.
Roger, Roger, thank you very much indeed, my friend.
Very happy to meet you, and hope to meet you again soon. In the meantime, all the very best of 7-3s and all the very best wishes for 19...
I did not go back and get it, and which I did.
Why?
I don't know, I just couldn't leave it there. And we left.
But you could have died going back for your barracks.
I know, yeah, sound ridiculous, and it did afterwards, but that was the case.
Did you fear death at that moment?
No. And I've never feared death, really, in any of the many incidents that had occurred to me or dangers that passed through. There were moments, I must say, when one thought that was really the end, but in terms of fear, I don't think it was there.
Do you mean that you've never known fear?
No, I have known fear, a different kind of fear.
What sort of fear?
Fear of myself. A fear of failing the people who have faith in me. Fear of not being able to live with myself as a result of letting them down in some way or another.
He says that he doesn't fear death. Do you believe him?
Yes, I do. I have the same attitude as he does. I think this has grown in the number of years that we've been together. That if you're in fear of death every day, life is not really worth living, to worry about it. When your time comes, your time comes, so why not live life to the full? And why worry about death?
But you yourself have said that many attempts have been made on his life. How can you come to terms with this? I mean, it's almost as if he may leave the house today and not come back.
Well, it's the same with any man who walks out of a house to go to work. He may not come back again.
It's rather, it applies rather more so to your husband than to most.
Yes, it does, but it's nothing that I worry about. I know he's well guarded. I know he won't do anything silly to for an accident to happen. And what if an accident happens? Well, there's very little anybody can do about it anyway.
You use the word accident rather than assassination attempt.
Yes, I suppose I do. I've never been here when there's been an assassination attempt on His Majesty. And each one he's come out all right with. But accidents on a car, or accidents on a horse, or in a plane, I think are far more liable in the everyday life than an assassination.
Not to your husband, though?
Well, this is the way I feel.
Is it,
I know he can be assassinated at any time, but